child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. Oh, this is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son.
Good morning, church. Why don't we stand to our feet? Since it's the Christmas season, we're doing things a little bit more special today. We have a choir joining us and a full band. And this morning, we just really want to give God all the praise, all the glory to him, just as the angels sang long ago of the birth of Jesus. And they were just, as the shepherds were in the field, the angels just came and they were declaring glory to God in the highest. And so this morning, we're going to do that together as a church family. Let's put our hands together.
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, and praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numbered, and praise when surrounded.
Praise 'cause you're
the voices.
Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Has been broken.
My heart sings hallelujah.
With a child God has spoken.
My heart sings hallelujah.
And everything changes. Everything changes. Angels come with words of wonder. From the curse we're under. Hallelujah. Here today, love's incarnation.
My heart sings hallelujah.
Come to seek and bring salvation.
My heart sings hallelujah.
Everything changes. Everything changes. Oh. Glory in the highest, God. We praise you, Savior, Savior to the lost and broken. Jesus, Jesus, our Redeemer, here to save us. My heart sings hallelujah. A little closer, sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Come a little closer, sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Come a little closer, sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Come a little closer, sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Come a little closer, sing a little louder, join with all the angels, worship him. Glory, glory in the highest, God, we praise you. Heart sings,
Well, welcome to IPC, everybody. You guys can have a seat for a minute. We're so happy you're here today. My name is Mike. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are just really happy that you're here to worship with us and sing. How much fun is it not only to have a full group of us down here singing, but these guys too, right? It's a blast. So, really excited. I walked in this morning. My general routine when I get here is I usually get here pretty early, and then I try to stay in my office for a little while and do a little work and prep, and I got nothing done this morning because these guys were just, I just had to be in here. So it's a lot of fun. We're so happy you're here today. If you're new or newer, which I know there are a few of you that I saw wander in that I don't think I've seen before, a couple of different ways that you can get connected with us to make sure that you don't miss anything. The easiest one is to join our email list. You go on our website, thriveatipc.com, you hit the QR code there, or you pull out the seat back card in front of you, the blue one, and it'll have any of the information that you're looking for. In a minute, I'm going to not only dismiss the kids, but I'm going to invite them up as well, and we'll have about a four-minute break in our service. So if you are new and you brought some kids this morning, you can bring the kids to their area, come back, and not miss anything. Well, we've been doing a food drive here over Christmas. It's for the Sunday Supper with Friends, led by Monica, who I think is here this morning. I saw her in here somewhere. We've been collecting non-perishables and items to put under the tree in the front. Monica serves somewhere between 100 and 150 people with food insecurities a week in downtown Woodstock, and depends on donations of food to do that. So if you've got some stuff that you think you can bring over the course of this week to keep filling out her cupboard, that would be awesome. On December 21st, we have what we're calling a Blue Christmas service. We understand that Christmas is a really exciting and joyful time, but also sometimes it's difficult. It's hard. You're dealing with a loss. Maybe something happened around this time of year that makes it not as joyful as you'd like it to be. And so we have designed a service just for you. If that's you, or if you know somebody in your life that's like that in dealing with those things, it's at 7 o'clock on December 21st. It's going to be in here. It's pretty interactive. There'll be you won't be asked to talk. Don't worry, it's not that kind of interactive. But there'll be different stations, things that you can do with art and music, just ways to express and talk about how you're feeling just between you and God. So we would encourage you to come to that. A really quick business announcement. We are going to have a brief elder election in the first couple weeks of the new year. I'm going to send an update video this week explaining why that's the case. Don't worry, nobody's leaving. It's actually the opposite. We're trying to keep them on for a little while longer, but this is your official notice, just that that's happening. And finally, Christmas Eve, we have two services this year on December the 23rd at 6. I almost said 7. I got confused with Blue Christmas at 6. And then at 10 a.m. on the 24th. So make sure you come to one of those two services. Invite friends and family. We'd love to see you there. We're not going to have any kids ministry, nursery, or anything that week. But what we are going to do is we're going to hold the balcony open for families that have littler kids that are maybe a little bit more, you know, they're runners. I've got a couple of runners. Right? We've got runners. Hi. Yes, that one. And so if you've got a kid that's a runner, we're going to take a couple of chairs out there in the front so they can stand and look. We'll put some soft toys up there and make sure that you as a family can engage in the service as well. I'm not sure how full that's going to be, so you might want to come early for that one. Okay, I'm going to invite the kids up. If you normally leave for kids ministry, that could be anybody from nursery if you think you can walk that far, all the way up to grade 5. I want you to come up here with me. We've cleared a couple of front rows out just to make room for you guys. So do you guys want to come up here? Don't be afraid. If you're brand new and you want to come and you want to bring a parent, that's okay. I know this is a little different. We don't normally do this. Come on up. I made sure we warned the folks in the balcony. Nobody's jumping. You're using the stairs, right? That's good. Okay, do you guys just want to sit kind of, ish, in this neighborhood? How are you guys doing? Good. Having a good week so far? All right. So we're going to talk a little bit about Advent this morning, and then I'm going to ask for a little bit of help from you guys in a second. So I want us to all watch the screens together as we learn a little bit about this week in Advent, and then I'm just going to chat it out with you, and I'm probably going to ask you a couple of questions. So let's watch the screens together.
Advent is an important time in the Christian calendar. It serves as a time of spiritual preparation, reflection, and expectation, reminding believers of Christ's first coming and the promise that he will return again. The traditional observance of Advent, with the lighting of candles, scripture readings, and reflections, has evolved over centuries to help Christians engage in a meaningful journey of faith at Christmas. It encourages a deliberate focus on the themes of hope, peace, joy, and love, which helps foster a deeper connection to the profound reality of God's presence in the person of Jesus Christ. This morning, we light the candle of joy. This candle represents the thrill that comes with anticipating Christ's birth. Amid a world filled with challenges, the joy candle reminds us that Jesus is the source of true happiness. In Luke chapter 2, an angel appears to a group of shepherds saying, "I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." Those shepherds were so excited that they got up right away and ran to find this gift that had been given to all people. Today, we celebrate the joy they felt and the joy we still find in the birth of Jesus.
Let me ask you guys a question. Joy is sort of a word that you probably don't use a lot. The word that you probably use is happy or excited, right? You probably don't wake up in the morning and go, "Hey, Mom, I'm really joyful today." You probably wake up and go, "Hey, I'm really happy today." And some of your parents are going, "The next time we hear that will be the first time." We're pretty close to Christmas. What makes you guys, what are you excited about? What are you happy about? What is making you joyful? Does anybody have any examples of anything that's making you joyful? Jackson, come on up here. Yeah. We're just going to, am I still on? Oh, that's good. Okay, come on up, Jackson. I just lost my mic back. What makes you happy or joyful or excited?
I like when...
It's okay. You're good. Yeah. Morgan, Desmond, Caroline, we'll go this way. Come on up. Just come up. I would like walk through you, but I'm going to step on somebody. It's not going to be good. Yeah.
To spend time with my family.
To spend time with your family.
I'm happy that I have a house.
You're happy that you have a house. That's awesome. Yeah, go ahead.
Jesus's birth.
You are happy about Jesus's birth.
My family.
Your family.
I'm happy that Jesus died on the cross for us.
That's awesome. Thanks, Veronica. Look, I even got your name right this week.
Eating dinner with my family.
Eating dinner with your family.
To have a family.
To have a family. You know what? I think that's okay. One more over here. Go ahead.
I like having snuggle times in the morning.
Nice. Oh. Me too. As a parent, you don't get to choose when that happens. It's just sort of you wake up and they're there or they're not. So there's a lot of things. Oh, yes. Go ahead.
I like that I have a little sister with me.
You like your little sister? Okay, I'm going to get your help, actually, Jackson, in a second. So just hold on, okay? So we light a couple of candles during Advent, and they symbolize things. Advent sort of talks about the whole season of Christmas, and we go through different sort of stages. We talk about hope and peace and joy and love, and this week is joy. And the way we sort of symbolize that in our church here is we light these candles. So we should have two candles lit. Does everybody see two candles lit over there? You see two candles lit? Look closely. Do you see two? No, only one, right? Because I, 2 minutes before the service, dunked the second one in the water. Right. And it was very hard to light when it was wet. So I need not just one person to help me, but I need two people to help me this morning light a couple of candles. So Morgan, you're the one that noticed. I'm going to turn this off now. So we're going to get Morgan and let's get Jackson. You two are going to come and let's go up these stairs. You guys go that way. I am stuck, so I'm going to go this way. Oh! And we're going to light these together. Now, I'm going to try to put this in here. Is this one full of water? No. Okay. Don't worry. If it gets full of water, everybody will be okay with it. And I will be especially. Woohoo! Okay. Do you know how to use one of these? So you push this forward, and then you pull this down. And then you're just going to stick it in until it sort of goes. If it goes. Donna tried to give me a second one today, and I said, no, the one up there works great. So push that forward, and then pull the trigger and hold it. Nice. Now slowly bring it in there. You got it. Oh, it's okay. Just press the trigger again. You want to do it together? Nice. Sweet. Nice job, Jackson. And Morgan, I'll get you to do this one, I think is the dry one. This one here. Nice. Nice. Do your parents let you play with fire? Okay. The parents don't let her play with fire, but Pastor Mike does. I'm not sure if that's good or bad. Okay. So every time, oh, thank you. Every time we see these candles, what we are reminded, what's in here? That's a great question. Right now, there's nothing. It's just some burlap. Do you know why? Because we're still a week early. Jesus isn't born till next week, which means to the prop department, you have a week. Okay. Is anybody due like tomorrow? That would be really cool. So what I want you guys to think about when you guys see these candles at the front of our church is as a reminder that Jesus is coming and that we spend a whole month really, really excited that that is going to happen. So speaking of the manger, I'm going to invite Rachel to come up here with you guys. She is going to lead you guys in Away in a Manger with the choir. Then I'm going to come up and pray, and then we're going to have our break and we're going to go. Does that sound good? Okay. Yeah.
Hello. Can you guys hear me? Okay, why don't we all stand up? And do you see these girls on the stage? They know the song Away in a Manger. Do you guys know that song too? Yes? Okay, so we're gonna sing that all together. And while we're singing that, if you wanna rock your baby Jesus in your arms, you can do that too, okay? All right. Sing this last verse together as a congregation.
Hear me, Lord Jesus, I am.
And it's a fun song, and a lot of times as kids we sing it, but it's really exciting that in 1 week we get to celebrate that Jesus was born, because we know all the things that Jesus did for us and why him being in that manger was such a big deal. So let's all pray together, and then I'll let you guys go have some fun in your kids' areas, okay? Let's pray. God, thanks so much for today. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship together. Thank you that we can come and sing and read scripture and learn. And I pray this morning that we would draw closer to you as we do all three. We're thankful for everybody who's given time during this Christmas season, people that have given to the tree and the food under it to Monica, people that have put in time here for music and others to sing. And Lord, we're thankful for those who have given to IPC over the past year, who continue to sacrifice so that we can continue to do your work here. We pray your blessing on all of those gifts that continue to happen each week. Let these kids have a great time up in their ministry and draw them a little bit closer to you. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Okay, you guys can go. We're going to take a 4-minute break. We'll be back really soon.
With angelic host proclaim.
heart and soul and voice. Give ye heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and lamb before him bow. He is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. So rejoice, oh rejoice. Hallelujah, Christ has come. So rejoice, lift your voice. Sing Emmanuel with us. Oh, rejoice. Good Christians all rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born. Has opened heaven. And is blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. So rejoice, oh rejoice. Hallelujah, Christ has come. So rejoice, lift your voice. Sing Emmanuel with us. Oh, all rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you one, calls you all. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save. So rejoice.
Rejoice,
hallelujah,
Christ has come. So rejoice, lift your voice, sing Emmanuel with us.
So rejoice, oh rejoice, hallelujah.
What a cool story that song tells. The fact that the angels came joyfully to sing, to let everybody know that Christ was on his way, and that our second birth would be something that would be so significant, even if we didn't know exactly what that meant yet. Let's pray together, and then I'm just going to sit here and tell you a little bit of what's been going on in my heart and my mind as we've worked up to this Sunday morning. God, thanks so much for today. Thank you that we get to come together as a church and worship and remember and recognize that you sent Christ to us. God, as a man in person, to come show us not only the way that we could be better, but that the world could be exactly as it was intended to be as Christ lived a full life without sin. And Lord, I just pray this morning as we work through that a little bit, that you would open our hearts and our minds to understanding what that means a little bit more. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, over the last couple of weeks, we've been going through this series called A New Hope, and what we've been trying to do a little bit is talk about, we so often talk about this story, the birth of Jesus, from our perspective. And what I've been trying to do the best I can is think about this story from God's perspective, God the Father's perspective, as he's preparing to send Christ down. And the first week, we talked about why we needed hope in the first place, that if you've been in this world for 10 minutes, you know that it's a little bit broken, and there are tremendous people doing tremendous things for people that they've never met before, and we see a lot of that, especially this time of year. But there are so many areas of the world that just are a little broken, and we need some hope. And then last week, we did a really fast run through the Old Testament, not to focus necessarily on that old covenant, but to show Christ and God through the entire history of our world right from the beginning. Because sometimes when we read our Bible, or if you haven't read your Bible very much before, there's like the Old Testament there, Jesus, you don't really see his name in it. And then the New Testament, you see it a lot. And so you think, where is Jesus in the Old Testament? And it was just a reminder that not only was he there, but he's been there since the beginning. And there's a risk that comes with trying to do a series like this. Because it's really easy for me to talk about things from my perspective, and it's really easy for you to talk about things from your perspective. But when we try to get into the heads of God and try to figure out maybe how he was feeling, we walk a fine line between trying to explore it and saying things that might not be right. And so as I've gone through this series, I've tried to walk that line a little bit. So this morning, I'm just going to talk this story out a little bit as the angel comes to Mary. And I'm just going to tell you what I've been thinking about and how I've sort of been putting this one together. And maybe it's something that you can go home and talk about too, because again, we've said this a few times in the last few weeks, so often we make ourselves the hero of every story, but when we focus on what God is doing in the world and for us, I think it changes our perspective. So in Luke, the birth of Jesus is foretold to Mary, and it sounds, it's not going to be up on the screen, I just want you to listen, it just sounds like this. It says, in the sixth month, that is the sixth month of somebody else's pregnancy, and if you're curious about that, grab your Bible and go back a chapter. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. And we talked about genealogies last week a little bit. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Now, I want to stop there for a second. We're like a week away from giving a bunch of people presents. And if you have kids or have had kids or have grandkids or have kids like in your orbit, this is one of the things that I learned, that it's like really fun to give gifts to adults and it's really fun to get gifts from adults, but it's really fun to give gifts to kids. And that gift-giving experience happens way before they open it, right? It happens like a month before, when you text the parent, or maybe tomorrow if you want to stress them out, and you say, hey, what should I get that kid of yours or this person or that person? And you throw some ideas back and forth, and then you start to get excited And then you go to the store and you look for the thing and you finally found it. And you buy it. And as you're walking out of the parking lot, you're already thinking about what their face is going to be like when they open the present. And then you go home and you wrap it. And depending on the age of the kid or whether or not you want to make it difficult, you use a little bit of tape or a lot of tape because you're shaping that experience, right? You're thinking about it. We've all got a box inside a box inside a box, and the last one was covered in hockey tape, or maybe that's just me. Thanks, Mom. But we've all had that experience. And as you're wrapping that gift, you're shaping the experience for the person who's going to get the gift. And then you just need to wait. You need to wait for that gift, the opportunity to give it, for the time to come. And then finally you show up at the person's house, the gift's under the tree, and you're having fun with everybody, but in the back of your mind you know that's where it is, and you're going to have a couple gifts on your lap, but you want to make sure that when that kid gets a hold of that gift, you look up. And in that moment, it doesn't matter what anybody else gave you, it doesn't matter what's in your lap, because you are locked on, and you are hoping that that person has the same reaction that you've been dreaming about for a month. Now, here's where it gets dangerous, because I'm going to try to get into God's head a little bit. I'm just a guy up here. I don't know. We've bounced this around a little bit. We've tried. I don't know what God was thinking. I don't know what he was feeling. But there was a world that was broken where the intention was for man and God to always be lockstep all the time, every moment. And at some point, that broke a little bit. And from that moment, God set out a plan to fix it. And this conversation is like the 9 months before. It's, hey, this gift is coming. We're getting ready. That, I think, would be exciting. Now, it's a bit of a mix because God knows that he's sending Christ to the world to die for your and my sin. And he's sending him to a world that is imperfect, even though he will be, and he won't be treated fairly, and the end will be full of a lot of suffering. But in the end, a connection, a reconnection will be made between man and God so that we can live with him forever. And I would bet that a God who intended to be in lockstep with you every moment of the way would be pretty excited about that solution. Mary is greatly troubled, yeah, at the words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You'll be with child and give birth to a son, and you will give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Okay, so now you got two people. You got one person who's really excited to tell you the news, at like you giving the gift, and then you've got the person, the first person in this case, that's receiving that gift, that's hearing about it for the first time, and they're processing. You ever got a gift and you open it and you got to process it for a minute? I think I told you this story last year when I was like 12, I went to my grandma's house and I was like, I want Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time, and I got bedding, which is not the same thing. And I had to process that for a minute. Like, right, you open the gift and you're like, this is really nice, I think. I'm excited. I don't know what to do. But then everybody's staring at you, so you've got to process it and you've got to figure it all out. So take that experience. And then your grandma isn't looking at you. An angel from heaven is looking at you instead. There's a lot going on here in this moment. By the way, I know Baba watches these every week. This is my camera, right? Baba, I loved that duvet. It was the greatest gift ever. I used it for way longer than I should, and we just bought a new one. So you know, it's been gone since long before then. Lauren and I were not sleeping under my duvet that was 25 years old. That would be gross. "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High God will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, that's the other one who's already pregnant, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who is said to be barren is in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible to God. So now you've got somebody who's betrothed to be married, but not married, in a culture where if you had an extramarital relationship, especially if you are betrothed, especially if you are a woman, there are dire consequences to that. I'm going to give birth to the Savior of the world, but what's everybody going to think? But, like, this is exciting? And God's like, yeah, we're excited. This is awesome. I'm so excited. I'm going to send an angel to you just to have this conversation with you. And Mary answers, I'm the Lord's servant. May it be as you have said. And then the angel left. What a gift. And then, like you, who buys the gift and has it sit in the closet, and you just have to dream and wait to see what the reaction of the kid is going to be, Mary has to just sit and wait. What is she thinking about? How is she processing that? And I think the question I've been asking over and over myself is, like, how is God processing that? We understand that God has a much different view of time than we do, and we can theologically debate that till forever. But whether it was a blink of an eye for him, or it felt like 9 months or 9 years or 9,000 years, the excitement that Christ would come to meet people must have been there for him. I don't know if you ever think about this, because again, sometimes when we look at Christianity and we look at everything that it encompasses right now, we see a lot of the negative, and we see the rules, and we see all this stuff that doesn't actually really matter. But at the core of this season is a gift that you were given that God was so excited to give to you. James and I were sitting in the office a couple weeks ago, and James went, you know, and I'm jumping ahead a week, but you know, when they told the shepherds, he could have just sent one angel, but he didn't. He sent a choir. God was jacked. God was ready to go. This was an exciting time. This was an exciting moment for us and for him, because the relationship was going to be mended once and for all. And that's what I want you to think about this week. As you wrap the gift that you're going to wrap, or you start pulling stuff out of the closet, or whatever that looks like for you, or on Christmas Eve at 3 o'clock when you finally get out to the Walmart and you have like 12 hours to be excited. During that time period, I want you not just to think about how excited you are to give that thing, but I want you to think about how excited God was to send Christ to you. And again, in about 4 months, we're going to talk about Easter, and we're going to talk about how most certainly those emotions must have been mixed, because it was a gift for us to mend a relationship that had been broken, but there was going to have to be a sacrifice there. But that was a little later. Right now, hey Mary, it's coming. Get ready. Let's go. And so as we move to this week, we have the benefit of hindsight. We know the rest of the story. We know how it ends and how it plays out. But if you don't know that, if this is the first time you're hearing this, or you've been brought to church by somebody for the first time in I don't know how long, and you're just kind of hanging in with like standing up and sitting down and kids running around and what that looks at, and I've just jumped 3 weeks into the middle of a series, and should I be paying attention, and I'm just sitting politely, and I'm not really sure what to make of all this, here's the only thing I want you to remember. This is it. You have a God that loves you very much. And in spite of all of the things that happen to us in this world that is a little bit broken, and the things that we do to other people, God looks at you as his treasure, as his greatest moment, his greatest creation, this person who matters so much, that when we made the mistakes and we walked away from the relationship that God wasn't content with, okay, they're going to go. God went, no, I'm going to make a way back. If you're having a week where you're not full of a lot of hope, where you don't know where the next great thing is coming from, where you're feeling a little bit down as a person, I want you to know that the world does that to us, but the beauty of this story is that Jesus came for you. And I understand that me just saying that is like the follow-up question is, what does that mean? I don't actually know what that means. I know. And I don't have all the time right now to explain the whole thing, but hopefully if you came with somebody, they can help you out. Hopefully if you're curious, maybe you'll chat with one of us. If you're not comfortable talking with anybody about it out loud yet, that's okay too, because we're sort of the middlemen. I would just say a short prayer somewhere. It could sound like, is that right? Do I really matter that much? Do you really care about me? What does that actually look like? It doesn't have to be fancy. It doesn't have to be high and holy language. Just ask, because I bet you'll find an answer, because whether it was 2,000 years ago or today or 2,000 years from now, God was excited for Christ to come for you. And that excitement started to build with that message to Mary. I'm going to pray. We're going to sing a little bit more this morning. But I would just encourage you to think about that. And as you prep this week, with every gift you wrap, consider that God wrapped one for you. And that whatever excitement you're feeling as you wrap that gift, I would guess that that excitement was amplified tenfold by a God who desired to be in relationship with you again. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for sending Jesus to us. Thank you for the gift of his life and his ministry. Thank you for his gift as a child to his parents. Thank you for his gift as a young adult and a teen wandering into the temple and learning more and gaining credibility and showing people that he was special and that he knew what he was talking about. And thank you for the development of the disciples and the apostles who eventually wrote things for us so that we could learn more about you too. God, we know that we have moments here in the world where we don't keep it perfect, where we mess it up, we could do better. We know that we have moments where we look to you and go, are you really the answer? Are we really feeling this? We know that there are people here that have never considered this, who are here to be polite to the person who offered to come to them today. But God, I just pray that we would all in this room, those that are watching online, those in our community here at IPC would know and feel the love that was intended by the gift of Jesus, and that we would be able to get as excited as I'm sure you were to give that gift to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you stand together as we sing our closing song?
We have heard on high, sweetly.
there's a lot of occasions where we get excited, right? People get excited, they're happy every day. We react differently when we get excited. There's moments where we're higher, there's moments where we're lower. We have a great group of musicians and a choir here this morning, not just so that we can flex that muscle and say, hey, look what we can do, we have a choir. We do it on special days like this because the excitement level is just turned up a little, right? The joy is just turned up a little. The hope is just turned up a little. And so we try to match that. And as much as we try to do that here, I cannot imagine that we come even close to the excitement that God had about being in relationship with you in the way that it was originally intended. If you have any questions about that, please, you can talk to anybody up here, anybody with a name tag. We have a prayer room out to the right. I'm up here. Come find one of us. We would love to dig into that story a little bit more. And remember this week, as you're prepping your gifts, that this is the week that represents that God prepped Mary for the gift that would eventually come to us, that would be Jesus as well. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful week. We hope to see you either on the 21st or the 23rd or the 24th so that we can celebrate this birth together. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. Merry Christmas. We'll see you again really soon. Thanks so much for coming this morning.